Yes, thank you so much, Adam, for that. You've set me up very nicely, and thanks to the Social Theory Center for bringing us together. I completely agree with Adam. It's very important that we have these conversations across movements, and for the academics out there, also across disciplines. I wanted to start more broadly and then get into the question of Palestine because I really like the title of Anti-Colonial Reckoning. And one thing I have noticed since coming to the UK is the erasure of colonialism and its present impact. Colonialism is spoken about as something of the past, it's over, and actually it's celebrated as we ended colonialism out of the benevolence of our hearts, we ended slavery out of the benevolence of our hearts. While there is still very much not just the history of colonialism living with us, there are unfinished colonialisms. Not just in Palestine or Kashmir or places like that, but even when we speak of settler colonies like Canada or Australia, indigenous communities in those settler colonies are still asking for sovereignty to this day. And they are still living with the slow violence, the racist slow violence of colonialism. So I would like to start by acknowledging that, especially as a passport holder of a settler colony, as the survivor of another settler colony, that colonialism is still very much with us today, and there hasn't really been a reckoning with the legacies of colonialism. On another note, we tend to, when we think of colonialism and analyzing it ourselves, to be sort of inflected with a major methodological nationalism, where we think that colonialism happened in one country, it had these legacies in a single country, and that's what we analyze. Largely because academically, we're often forced to, work on one state to define ourselves and not look at other places. But colonialism itself did not function in the boxes of statehood. There was actually major circulation of ideas, methodologies, methods, logics, of how colonialism functioned. From the very basics of policing, the idea of reserves circulates from Canada to apartheid South Africa, then we see it recirculating around the world. Fingerprinting comes from legacies of policing in India. Things like passports, those are all colonial legacies that circulated across empires. So, in our own analysis of colonialism, we need to think through, I think, a lot more these circuits and interconnections, not just in terms of analogy, but actually analysis of how these methods circulated, how the racialization processes also circulated in the movement of people. This is especially useful when we think around the very heavy anti-migrant xenophobia that we are facing today. Its legacies really lie with the movement of people through colonialism, many times the enforced movement of people through colonialism. So making these connections very clear around the circulation that takes place across empires, within empires, is really important for our own analysis. On the other hand, it's not just the solidarities of empire. There is also an anti-colonial solidarity that often gets forgotten in these conversations. Our own histories of anti-colonialism get erased. Oftentimes, even in discussions around decolonization today, it's as if the term came up yesterday and it's only about decolonizing our curricula, when in reality, there have been anti-colonial movements that people fought, people struggled, people put their lives on the line, but also anti-colonial intellectuals, anti-colonial ordinary people who have given us legacies to learn from and to work through. And those legacies are quite important, and we don't get to read about them, we don't get to acknowledge them or learn from them. So I think for me, centering these anti-colonial solidarities, our anti-colonial history is really, really important. It also pushes us, in the way Adam was suggesting, to go beyond just individual self-flagellation, to think through how to build movements and how to build solidarities across movements. And here, the point about analogy is really relevant because what we need is not simply there's policing here, there's policing there, there's arms trade here, there's arms trade there. The actual connections between the powers that be are much deeper rooted. They are connections of capital, they are connections of doctrines that travel, they are connections of how the police operates on multiple levels, how the arms industry operates on multiple levels and on an international scale. So when we build our own solidarity, we need to be thinking of specificity of our own contexts, but also much more deeply beyond simply naming and analogies. In the Palestinian case, to speak about Palestine, sometimes we run towards analogies, to be very honest, in a very desperate state of needing anyone to hear and acknowledge that there is a systematic crisis of occupation, illegal military occupation, and settler colonialism that has happened there. And sometimes the only way that is heard is if we say, hey, look, it's like South Africa. Hey, look, it's like these other places. Otherwise, there has been such a systematic denial of Palestinian history, of the Palestinian narrative, of the Palestinian voice, that these analogies are the only ways that it becomes present. And I say this with great sadness, because I think analogies are quite important and they're really relevant to how we think through, especially on, you know, once you start to speak about international law, it's quite relevant how these doctrines come about. But on the other hand, simple analogy is not really our answer. We need a much deeper analysis of how the logics of settler colonialism and militarism are integrated across space, but also slightly different across context. In Palestine today, we still have a complete lack of acknowledgement of the settler colonial project that was set upon against the Palestinian people. Palestinian citizens of Israel are still treated as third-class citizens. Palestinians in the 1967 occupied territories still live with a daily military occupation that controls every aspect of daily life, from how you go to school, when you get a driver's license, etc. Of course, Palestinians in the Gaza Strip have been living under a 13-year military siege. And Palestinian refugees are still denied the right of return simply for being the wrong religion and continue to be the largest refugee population around the world. Now, this is the basic reality of the situation. There is a population that has been living against and fighting against and surviving a military occupation that's set on the destruction of its history, that say that Palestinians do not exist as a people. Speaking of colonialism, the British state has very much colluded with this reality in erasing Palestinians, in siding with the Israeli state, whether through the ongoing arms trade, military support, etc. But even on the level of aesthetics and narrative, for example, a few years back, there was celebrations of the Balfour Declaration. Now, the Balfour Declaration was a declaration by a British lord called Balfour that decided there should be a Jewish homeland in Palestine without once acknowledging the indigenous people that lived there, without once asking them. It said there should be two peoples that live side by side. For Palestinians, the Balfour Declaration is a day of mourning and is a day of protest. Yet this was largely celebrated by the British state. Theresa May went to a gathering and she said, we are very proud of pioneering role in the creation of the State of Israel, without once acknowledging what the creation of the State of Israel meant for the 750,000 Palestinians that were ethnically cleansed at that point in time. But very importantly, she continued to say, but as we work together towards Balfour's vision of peaceful coexistence, we must be equally clear that there can never be any excuses for boycotts, divestments, and sanctions. So putting up the Balfour Declaration as something to be proud about as a British legacy, although it is very much within the colonial legacy, it was also a push to shut down a Palestinian nonviolent movement that is asking very simply for ending complicity in what happens in Palestine, ending complicity of universities, of trade unions, of states in supporting the status quo that continues to be Israeli dominance over the Palestinian people. And that's why I wanted to start with the point that colonialism is very much still alive and with us today, when British prime ministers can still celebrate the Balfour Declaration, completely erasing the suffering that Palestinians have had to endure for decades, and still continue to endure and fight against. and I'll leave it at that. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Rafif. So inspirational, as always, both of you. Do we have any questions from the audience before I add my own questions and reflections? If you wish, you are welcome to unmute yourself and speak.